You are listening to a free version of Majority Report with Sam Steeter. To support the show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeter.
It is Wednesday, April 19th, 2017. My name is Michael Brooks, and I'm Michael Wednesday, and this is the four-time award-winning Majority Report. We're broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On today's program, South African revolutionary, freedom fighter, anti-apartheid activist, and politician, and now activist again, Ronnie Kasrils, on what led him to his historic work for the African National Congress, what he's trying to do in South Africa today, and the deeper story behind the crisis in South Africa, and how to resist Trump here. And Benjamin Dixon, host of The Benjamin Dixon Show on Democratic sort of gains in Georgia, Kansas, possibly Montana, the Unity Tour with Bernie and Tom Perez. And he's got an exciting announcement for everybody in the Majority Report universe. Ronnie Kasrils and Benjamin Dixon. The United States still talking tough with North Korea as North Korea promises to defend themselves. That stalemate continues. Mike Pence, apparently the era of strategic patience is over, but what does that actually mean as the terrifying standoff in the peninsula continues? Israel rules out negotiations with prisoners, Palestinian prisoners, on hunger strike as part of a resistance to that human rights crisis. John Ossoff is off to the next round, leading things last night, but it might not be enough to actually win in a head-to-head race with a Republican candidate. Theresa May calls a snap election in the UK, and France's Mélenchon, man of the hard left, is surging in the polls. And what does Turkey's referendum actually mean as President Erdogan grabs more power and gets a congratulations from a man who wishes he could be Erdogan, our own buffoon jackass president, Donald Trump? And this just in, it looks like Billow.
Say, baby, put down that pipe and get my pipe up.
He said that stuff like that a lot, apparently. And now his luck as a serial harasser might just be coming to an end as Fox News continues to succumb to the drumbeat and the fallout of apparently running a, not only a Republican propaganda platform, but really just a organized sexual harassment network.
MF-er, I want more iced tea.
That's what people are saying. It's enough with Bill O'Reilly. Gabe Sherman is reporting as of 11:20 a.m. And he writes for New York Magazine. He's the kind of premier Fox News watcher and reporter. He wrote the book. And apparently the Murdochs have decided that Bill O'Reilly's 21-year run at Fox News will come to an end. O'Reilly's, of course, on vacation right now. According to sources briefed in a discussion, networks executives are preparing to announce O'Reilly's departure before he returns from an Italian vacation on April 24th. Now, the big questions are how the exit will look and who will replace him. Last night, it was revealed that a new woman had stepped forward, not wanting money. I don't think she had even received a payout for her initial sexual harassment. I don't remember what her job title was, but she wasn't working on air. She was a black woman, and apparently O'Reilly called her hot chocolate and made animal noises at her. So that was the latest in the drumbeat of this guy's harassment. I mean, you know, he obviously talked like the idiot characters he wrote in his terrible novel. And, you know, I mean, we did this last week, but go check out any montage of Bill O'Reilly condemning rappers and basketball players and talking about the moral decline of America and spewing racism and homophobia and everything else. And of course, what he was just sort of, you know, knockoff madman stuff. Total scumbag for a complete scumbag network, which still is obviously peddling far-right propaganda. We haven't reached a point in our society where we realize it's also a moral crisis to be gloating about dropping a massive bomb in Afghanistan. But at least we're moving in baby steps to deal with systemic sexual harassment and most likely criminal conduct. So apparently, goodbye Bill O'Reilly. He might try to make the move to the internet, but I don't know. I mean, his audience is not an internet audience overall. I mean, his base is pretty up there in the demos.
I mean, we're doing our part to try to get him an internet audience.
Yes.
I think maybe this week or in the future weeks, we're going to have Kindler on to take a look at a few of the last appearances on Bill O'Reilly of Dennis Miller.
Well, that's
D-Man.
What you really got to be worrying about right now, the
yeah,
D-Man.
This is bad
that
news.
That was the last thing that the D-Man had going.
This is bad news for Dennis Miller. That's a
bad.
Weekly check that was probably pretty nice for Dennis Miller.
That was probably pretty nice for Dennis Miller. Really quickly, do you guys have in front of you, we want to tell everybody just really briefly about the JustCoffee.coop deal that we have going for the month of April. It should be on the blog. I know that the code is 30% off of the Majority Report blend, and I believe it is MR Spring 17, but I want that to be double-checked. Yes. MR Spring 17, JustCoffee.coop. Fresh 2 Dope Boys dropped just recently, just yesterday, in fact. And I already feel like vacation is very clearly over. Any remnant of like vacation mode is kind of a wrap, I feel like. Back fully in the swing of things. No, mine lasted for like 2 days. I had a 2-day stretch. Not for you?
No.
No. Oh, I'm sorry. Wine and yoga help if I actually did those things. All right, we're going to be right back with do a little bit of yoga. We'll be back with Ronnie Kasrils on the Majority Report. We're talking about resistance, South Africa, and structurally understanding the crisis we're in today. We'll be right back on the Majority Report.
Something like this, you know what I'm saying? Stay up on this. Keep it on and on and on and on and you know what I'm saying? Big Nas, Grand Wizard, dog, what is it like? Ha. Know what I'm saying? Yo, gang. I rap for listeners, blunt heads, fly ladies, and prisoners, Hennessy holders, and old school and then I'll be dissing the unofficials that mold woolly tie. I dropped out of coolie high, gas the block, book at cutie pie, jungle survivor, move the lava, my man put the battery.
Welcome back to the Majority Report. I'm Michael Brooks. I'm sorry about that technical difficulty. Joining us now is Ronnie Kasrils. He is a legendary South African freedom fighter. He served as a deputy defense minister under Nelson Mandela, minister of intelligence under Thabo Mbeki, and water minister under Thabo Mbeki as well. Ronnie, are you there?
I am. Good evening from South Africa.
Good afternoon from Brooklyn, New York. It's great to be talking with you again. Thank you so much for joining us. Before we get to the bigger sort of terrain that we get to, that we'll get to in South Africa and hopefully also in the United States, Ronnie, can you tell everybody just briefly how you came to be who you are? What got you into politics? What radicalized your politics and your journey to a certain extent?
Okay, well, here goes with a revelation about how ancient I am. I grew up in Johannesburg, a part called Yeovil, which I think with a lot of Jewish immigrants was a bit like parts of New York I've heard about and been to. My father was a factory worker, salesman kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And I grew up in Johannesburg in the war years. I was affected by the war against fascism. There was anti-Semitism to some degree in South Africa. But what was happening in Nazi Germany and Europe affected me as I grew up. So I found that as a youngster, I was very empathetic to the suffering of black people that was so visible even to a young kid. And I had parents who encouraged me to be that way, a very sweet mother, not a political family as such, but who kept talking about doing unto others what you would want them to do unto you. Anyway, to come to my early adult life, I was a scriptwriter for a film company near the famous African township of Alexander Township in the north of Johannesburg, and was beginning to interact across the color bar line when the Sharpeville Massacre took place.
Can you explain that briefly for our listeners?
That's March 1960, mm-hmm. peaceful demonstration of African people, of the black people, who had to carry special identity papers. If they didn't have them on them, they just disappeared into the jails. It was very unpopular. It was a way of controlling African labor, African movement in and out of the cities and so on. And this led to this infamous massacre, 69 people shot down, 250 dreadfully wounded. And I then decided that if I was to make something of my life, I actually needed to take a stand in the country I lived in on that issue. I would say a bit like the American civil rights movement and the young whites who were drawn into it, and some who got murdered, as we know. Mm-hmm. Deep south of the United States, there were aspects there that were similar to South Africa. I'm not saying I was that up to date with it then, but we were actually quite aware of what was taking place in America, I must say, with Martin Luther King Jr. and so on. It had actually impressed us to a degree when I had joined of doing some of the things that were taking place in America, breaking some of the apartheid laws of not being able to sit with black people in public and, you know, those dreadful segregation aspects. But I very quickly became involved with the ANC, with the South African Communist Party, and with the ANC's armed wing, Umkhonto weSizwe, mm-hmm. which is something I became very involved in for a very long period of my time, both in South Africa in terms of a sabotage campaign led by Mandela to announce the new method of struggle, basically because the ANC had come to see that the peaceful forms of struggle which it had been wedded to were no longer optimal, that you couldn't make change in South Africa with nonviolence alone. But it wasn't terrorism. It was very much focused in terms of the masses and getting mass struggle reignited after the bannings of the ANC, PAC, and Communist Party. But to cut a long story short, I managed to evade the authorities in that period. A lot of the comrades I was with went to prison for very long periods. Some died in detention. And I basically found myself for something like 27 years in exile, working for the ANC in the neighboring territories in Angola and Mozambique, and going for further military training, directing operations until we could come back into the country in 1990 when the regime decided and agreed to negotiate with Mandela's ANC. I then became, as you've reported, a minister serving in both his government and Thabo Mbeki's until I resigned when the ANC unceremoniously recalled Mbeki from presidency in a virtual putsch, I would say, in 2008. And from then on, I've tended to operate outside of the structures of the ANC, raising my voice with civil society, with the trade unions, against corruption, against the descent into crony capitalism, and all the sins that we've seen taking place in South Africa under Jacob Zuma since. In a nutshell, I'm breathless as a result.
And no one would hold it against you. You know, many people have retired after accomplishing far less. But what is interesting to me, I mean, first I want to ask you just one brief historical question, because this has been something that I've actually been writing and thinking about a lot. And then we'll get to the present with Jacob Zuma. But there was an official, and in some ways, it's certainly from a kind of global perspective, I don't think it's, you know, many people are aware of this, that there actually was a kind of official opposition to apartheid. There was a progressive federal party. There was a party that acted in South African parliament during apartheid. They accepted that it could be a whites-only party. They accepted the sort of governing frameworks, but they sort of posed a somewhat liberal alternative to apartheid. And I'm just curious as to what made you kind of skip that route and go directly to this kind of broader sense of confrontation. And I ask that not because, you know, the situation we're in the United States is radically different, but in some ways we have, you know, an official opposition party that misses so much of the structural problems that led to the dissent we're in. And I think people are looking for kind of broader outlets and venues. It's very different, but there are some parallels. And I'm just curious, what sort of got you to that radicalism directly in terms of really going to the kind of root of the problem in apartheid South Africa?
Yes, thanks. I followed what you've said, and I can see where you're going with it. And I've got a lot of friends in the States, and a couple of months ago, I was at a wedding in Jamaica, which drew a lot of Americans, including Amy Goodman, your Amy.
Yeah.
So I know how people are responding to what's occurred since Obama. In terms of South Africa, it's not quite like what you've had.
Right,
but there are certain parallels. So we're talking about a very young Ronnie Kasrils who couldn't have really been, say, around or close to the mainstream politics of South Africa, as of course many good people in the States have been close to the Democratic Party in your two-party system. But one's consciousness in South Africa under very extreme conditions, which I guess is what you're facing in the States now, your thought processes, your actions, your consciousness does speed up. So I came from a family, I said they weren't very political, but they did like a lot of the English-speaking South Africans, which amongst the whites then and now is about 40%, the other 60 being Afrikaans speakers with a background from Germany and the Netherlands and so on, way back, centuries back. So the kind of English opposition, which had been the ruling party for much of the first part of the 20th century, up to the time the National Party of the Afrikaners, the Apartheid Party, came in 1948, that had been a stolid, pretty conservative, racist party, mm-hmm. but it pretended to be a little bit more emancipated than the cross racism of the right wing opposition that it faced. And my parents tended to vote that party in, as a lot of their peers did, election after election. And most of South African small Jewish population tended to vote for them. I reckon the first couple of years of adulthood, I had seen this was absolutely out of the question for me, because they prattled on about racism. And when I was just leaving school, there was a breakaway from it led by the very redoubtable liberal Helen Suzman, who was voted in basically by a Jewish vote in a very well-off constituency of Johannesburg. Mm-hmm. And she became the lone voice of this progressive party. Mandela and company really came to appreciate her, because she was the lone voice in parliament that raised the issues of the prisoners, the extremes of apartheid. She would come to the prisons, to Robben Island, to visit them, to see how they were being treated, etc. And that was something that took me up a little bit, and I voted for them in my first election when I could vote, 1962, although I was already a member of the ANC, but this was this one white party that at least was raising a voice of truth. I saw for myself, and I was critical of it, that it couldn't really go far, but it opened things up. And of course, as a white voter, and no blacks were allowed to vote, no mixed race people could vote in terms of the national election, I gave it my vote because I felt this was the best I could do. But I was actually quite critical, and I attended some of their parties, their political party constituencies, and raised my questions from the floor. In the brief period that I was still able to operate in South Africa, I had to leave in 1963 when I went into exile. So this party, we watched its progress over the next 30 years, in fact, and it grew, it managed to garner support amongst the whites. By the time we were reaching the real change in South Africa in 1990, it had some substantial support in the white parliament. And there were some interactions between it and the ANC, but we could see this was a very conservative party for the kind of change that was coming. It, incidentally, gave birth and rise to the new main opposition in South Africa, the Democratic Alliance, which at last is beginning to attract blacks into its ranks. But South Africa meant, and for me, in that short period of civic involvement, and then the long period of resistance, struggle, that there was no way that I would look, as some young radical whites did, for political career in that party, or, right, or for voting for it, that for me, I could see this was really never going to deliver the goods. It was simply a party of business and of domination by business, which it still is today, although it has about 25% of the vote. The ANC called it a racist party because it was mainly whites, with a lot of the previous apartheid supporters in its ranks. But in the last election, the last 5 years, it's created black leaders, men and women who have come to the fore, quite articulate. It's giving the ANC a run for its money, very critical in Parliament and so on. It's taken to the streets recently with other more radical opposition parties to the ANC, but smaller ones, and is making a big noise. But nevertheless, it'll never attract my attention or my support, because it basically remains the party of business. Although it's attracting unemployed blacks, working class blacks, but a lot of middle class black people. But essentially, you ask yourself, well, what is it standing for? And it's a voice of business in this country.
So then,
I think, yeah. Anyway,
Ronnie, I actually wanted that helps us actually get to the next place I wanted to go, to sort of situating, and I think there are lessons here for the United States in the situation we're in terms of late-stage capitalism, a particularly aggressive form of crony capitalism. You did the sort of overview of your experience, because you're a contemporary and have experience with these figures, like the current president, Jacob Zuma, the former president, Thabo Mbeki. But the narrative that you tell includes, I mean, my understanding is that maybe in some ways you and Thabo Mbeki might not have necessarily the same politics, but you thought his treatment was disgraceful and he served as a good president. Obviously, this sort of global admiration for Nelson Mandela. But you've told this narrative that part of the reason that the ANC has sort of gone in this crony capitalist direction is really because of the first bargain with capitalism. The ANC always had several different currents. It was never purely a Marxist organization, but it was a liberation organization. And the emphasis on the collapse of apartheid not addressing the economic structures which sustained apartheid in the same level as the obvious, you know, just sort of overt forms of discrimination and apartheid structure, that sort of bargain with capitalism led to this ongoing situation of inequality, and now what Jacob Zuma is doing with the country. Maybe you could kind of, in the last little bit of time here, speak to that and then explain what exactly Zuma is doing.
Right. Well, I'll try in the short time.
Yeah, no, but take some time, yeah.
Let me say I have tremendous admiration for Mbeki, who's absolutely incorruptible, as Mandela was. Although, by the way, Mandela had quite a liking for the sort of more glamorous life and the kind of celebrities he liked to rub shoulders
with. Like the Spice Girls.
You know, I mean, aspects like that, which some of us really found distasteful. You'll never find that with Mbeki. More of a puritanical person. Mm-hmm. Both of them, of course, eschew personal wealth and corruption and stand up against it. There was a difference between them because Mandela was very outspoken on the HIV issue, and Mbeki, it's regarded that he made certain major errors. But he did that as in terms of a process of people, I would say, a fault in judgment, that nothing in terms of his own power and greed or wealth of that kind. However, we came out of a revolutionary struggle and a revolutionary movement which was inclined to socialism. It was a broad church, but very strong in terms of working class membership and revolutionary ideals, not to create the Red Revolution, but certainly to create a South Africa that, in Mandela's words, would be focused on the poorest of the poor. And if that meant anything, it meant putting into practice the famous Freedom Charter, which was adopted by over 3,000 delegates from all over the country under the noses of the apartheid police in 1955. And that spelt out returning land to those who were the tillers, so a real agrarian reform, the question of nationalization of the heights of the economy, the mines, the banks, the monopoly industries, etc. And it's really when Mandela, 2 years after being released from prison, so we're looking at 1992, kind of moves away from that and is influenced very much by the IMF and the World Bank and the people he's meeting there at Davos in Switzerland. And he basically says, look, we've got to get this political power. And of course he's right. What can you do without getting political power under your control? You can't do anything. He says, on that basis, we must realize we're not going to make this country work and the system work if we start nationalizing, and we'll be isolated internationally and the investments won't come in, and then where will we be? And Mbeki's very much part of it, and to say mea culpa, because the Chris Hines, the Joe Slovos, the left of the ANC, the Communist Party, we all say, look, let's realize we do have to get this changed. We have to get to a national election. We've got to get political power, and then we can start making the change. So I've coined the term the Faustian Pact.
Right.
Not to say that Mandela's the betrayer or Mbeki or an individual, but all of us collectively, we now in a, within a gross extreme form of capitalism and racism, and we're taking that option, and we don't realize how we're getting sucked into the system. We're now going with the Washington consensus. Right. And this term, the neoliberal economy, which we basically is about the free capitalist market economy. And once you enter that, you're really caught up in it. And we miss a marvelous opportunity when we're at the height of revolutionary ascendancy. From then on, things really started taking a dive. And we get more and more engulfed in that. with an Mbeki there, we've got somebody who's a supreme strategist who has an understanding of the world and where South Africa should be placed in it, but it's a very fine line, a tightrope he's walking. And
the paradox, can I just elaborate for just one moment, but it's like the paradox of a guy who on one hand was pushing through, I think the program was GEAR, which was growth redistribution and development, and that was during Mandela. So pushing a very orthodox neoliberal line, and then at the same time also giving lectures and speeches where he would talk about the globalization of apartheid and recognizing that the economic conditions that the West and the Western corporate sector was pushing on the rest of the world was a system that has, I mean, very overtly exploded in everybody's face over the last several years, but even back then was an engine of immense inequality.
Exactly. You're absolutely on the point there. Just to say that outside of the actual economic diktat, etc., what is also happening is a tendency not to keep the fires alive amongst the masses, amongst the people, amongst your followers. And then a hegemony creeps in which those who are the crony capitalists, those who simply want to benefit for themselves, they take over. This is then the ascendancy of the Jacob Zumas and the patronage system that goes with it, that gets worse and worse. And the political consciousness then is so acutely and badly affected that you get a demobilization of your constituency. And these are the guys that begin to rule the roost. And that's basically the kind of corruption and patronage system that we've entered into in South Africa. I said Mbeki's trying. He's got this worldview. He has an understanding for sure. He's got a Marxist brain, but he's trying to take us along a precipice, or I once said it was walking the tightrope. And he could perhaps do it, but when he's not there, you then have somebody like Jacob Zuma, who's already corrupt. He's been involved in corruption. His financial advisor has been sentenced, and he was connected with it. He was lucky he wasn't charged. He gets away with all of that, and there's then the green light for the corruption that is taking place. Right. So we get into that. What we don't have on the American side is the imperialist nature of South Africa.
Right.
And the military aggression, which is what you now face, but
right.
you face it from whatever party, Republican or Democrat.
Right.
So that aspect we don't have, but we obviously part of the whole global process, and we're very worried, those of us who are aware to what's happening in terms of a possible being on the possible eve of a war, what's happening in North Korea,
right.
in Syria, the attacks there, where there was absolutely no proof whatsoever that Assad had used poison gas on his own people, blah, blah, blah. So, you know, there is that difference between South Africa and your country and, of course, the European Union and Britain.
Do you think, as a final question, and I will just note, maybe this is for another conversation, I know some people, because I do think Assad, I didn't support the strikes, but I do think Assad was the person who delivered those attacks. But there'll be many members of the audience who are going to gleefully report that I was schooled by you, which is great. But anyways, do you think I don't know how to articulate this, but the final question I would have is, you're talking about civil society movements in South Africa. We know in the United States that in order to not just deal with Trump, but the kind of larger structures that you're talking about in terms of the kind of imperial nature of the system and the underlying problems, it's definitely, it might be delivered through aspects of the Democratic Party on some domestic issues, but certainly overall not internationally in terms of how we conduct ourselves in the world and whose interests we're acting on behalf. It seems like we've had some social emancipation over the past couple of decades, but this market system, which is eating everything away, is this sort of, that's the variable that just doesn't seem to be able to really be moved. And so is it, you know, I guess, where do you find the ripest sources of resistance or hope in the current environment, or do you?
Well, you know what I want to say?
Yeah.
That you living in the citadel of imperialism, of aggression, of capitalism, you're the world power. That's daunting.
Yeah.
On the other hand, and you're asking me about where do we, people like myself, find some source of inspiration in our country, I want to just turn that, if you don't mind, to you, to your listeners, to your people. I think it's absolutely magnificent how we see time and time again, and I mentioned, to start with the civil rights movement, which was glorious, and where you began to unite black and white in the United States. But what we've seen in the streets of America in terms of the Occupy movement, the anti-war movement, the anti-race issues, the coming together of support, Black Lives Matter, the incredible inspiration which your civil movement of the states need to realize. And I know sometimes when it's so dark and when you're faced with such incredible militarism and a police state almost, where you don't realize the extent to which your protests actually fire and inspire those of us throughout the world. And from that point of view, I think the aspects of the civil society in the States on so many planes that is leading a struggle, a fight back, and this is affecting all of us throughout the world. Of course, one's got to find the motive forces for this in one's own society. And in South Africa, where we've had, you've got this two-party state or dictatorship, I'll put that in quotes, as Marx would really call bourgeois democracy, right, of this extreme kind. And we've had the emergence of something I was so happy with. Every time, every election, we managed to pump up the ANC's vote. From the first election under Mandela, it was 62. Under Mbeki, in terms of our fourth election, we got to almost 70%. It immediately started sliding back under Zuma. Right. It went down to 52% in national local elections in 2016. And our people were demobilized. And a few of us started raising our voices, and small groups did. And then the trade union began splitting in some sections because they were so supporting Zuma and had supported him against Mbeki, realized that they had got things wrong. Right. And we got the labor movement, middle class elements, young people, students, youth, unemployed, women, gender issues, because Zuma and his group, right, are just so dreadful in relation to gender factors. So we are seeing, building up right now as we speak, a huge marches on Zuma, on our government, on our parliament. We had something they say like about 200,000 in the streets just a week ago. And this is, you know, this is in a country that's, what, a tenth of the population, right, of the states.
So the lesson is
very, very big.
Yeah. So the lesson, I guess, is in everywhere in the United States and South Africa, stay on the streets and look to where there's light. Ronnie Kasrils, as I always say, it really is an honor to have you on.
Okay, the one thing to say from the streets, we've got to build organization.
Right.
You see, we can't just do it on the streets.
Right.
We've got to build the revolutionary organizations.
Right, right.
Thanks very much, Mark.
Right. Ronnie Kasrils, I appreciate your time immensely. I hope we can do it again sometime soon.
Very grateful. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay, everybody, we will be right back with Benjamin Dixon on the Majority Report.
Hold on to your insecurity.
back to the Majority Report. Joining us now is Benjamin Dixon. He's the host of the Benjamin Dixon Show. Ben, thanks for joining us.
Hey, man. Thanks for having me. Always a pleasure.
Always a pleasure. It's been a little too long. Yeah, man. You really, your connection, this is the best Skype connection I think I've ever experienced in my life.
Best audio we've ever heard. Wow.
No, but this isn't just the best audio on the Majority Report. It's like the best audio of my use of Skype ever.
Yeah, it's like he's coming
scenario.
From inside the studio right now.
Yeah, I feel like you're sitting next to me, man. This is great.
You know, it's technology, right? We make it happen when we can. Better than a phone call, right?
Well, I mean, you do. My experience of Skype is a bit different. But anyways, that being as it may, let's start with these congressional elections. We had John Ossoff last night, you know, performing well, making it into the runoff. We had the margin cut significantly in Kansas. We have this race in Montana with Quest, which I'm more interested in kind of substantively. Ossoff, even if he wins, which is important, he's not going to be a particularly exciting congressman, most likely. You know, Quest might. He might actually be a really good populist. But I just want to kind of get your sort of general read on it, everything from how does this register in terms of the anti-Trump sentiment. Where are we at with our struggles with the ossified Democratic Party, and what are things looking like looking like moving forward?
Yeah, so you know, this is a quick referendum on Trump. You know, this generally happens with any new president from a different party, right? A switch in the parties, but you see it maybe 6 to 9 months in, and you definitely see it in the midterm. So this is a quick referendum on Trump to have this flip inside of that district with Ossoff. So in terms of the fight against Trump, it really does speak to how not even polarizing, but how toxic Trump quickly became for people who were once thought they could ride on his coattails. But you said something key there, right? You know, it's one thing to have someone to fight back against Trump, but then it's also something else to have someone who's going to actually fight positively for the values that you stand for. And, you know, for all intents and purposes, you know, Ossoff, we'll decide how to pronounce his name in a minute. But, you know, all intents and purposes, he's pretty much a milquetoast he's a milquetoast neoliberal.
Right.
Now and so you have this quagmire, right? Do you push him so that we can eventually split the government and not give Trump the majorities he needs to get his agenda across? Or are you disillusioned because the Democratic Party is still pushing these third way Democrats?
So there's two different ways of looking at that, I think. I mean, number one, there's no doubt that when you're looking at a district like the Thompson race in Kansas, certainly this race in Montana, there are places in the country where the right thing to do, which is, you know, we could keep using Bernie for shorthand, but in some ways I think we need to get away from that. Bernie's great and we wouldn't be where we are without Bernie, frankly. But, you know, there's a place where a populist, anti-corporate, economic, left-wing agenda is both what the country desperately needs and also the only strategy where you're going to put certain places into play. Now, suburban Georgia and an affluent district where Hillary Clinton actually significantly outperformed Obama and was 2 points shy of Trump and has been represented, you know, by Newt Gingrich and then Tom Price for decades. Programmatically, and, you know, it makes sense that you would run a boring, mediocre suburban Democrat, which is probably what the guy is. Now, that is politically justifiable. On the other hand, what the problem might be is, you know, they didn't move and put money into Kansas, the DNC.
Right.
Do they still just feel so much more? It's one thing to practically say, okay, I can get that as a left guy because I want to be reality based. I understand why a guy like Ossoff is the pick for Georgia. But what I don't understand is why in the same basic scenario where you just got to be shooting threes in all of these districts because to put the pressure on, why do they still seem so much more comfortable with the kind of Clinton mediocrity and not the progressive insurgency? Looks like they're moving in Montana, but what's that about? Mm-hmm.
So, you know what? I can't honestly say I understand what it's about other than protecting what they know and continuing to do the same political maneuvers that they're familiar with. You know, and that's being gracious to them, right? You know, that's saying that they're just going with the routine that they understand.
Right.
But if we're really talking about getting these majorities and eventually flipping Congress, you have to put money behind who has the best chance to win. And the race in Kansas, you know, it's really obscene that they did not put any support behind him, especially when you see what this race in Georgia looked like, how what it looks like when the Democratic Party gets behind somebody who's basically a no name. I mean, Ossoff, whatever. He's now everybody knows his name, maybe not how to pronounce it, but everyone knows his name. Celebrities roll out for him. And in the Kansas race, he would not have needed, as much as they rolled out for Ossoff. So, if I'm going to be gracious and give them the benefit of the doubt, which I don't think we have to, I would say they're just accustomed to running their same playbooks that they're always accustomed to doing. But if you really go underneath the surface, I really believe that this is just a selection of the type of Democrats that they want in D.C. They would rather not get a progressive wing of the Democratic Party to actually grow if they can help avoid it. And so to me, that says that they're not as interested in beating back against the Trump agenda as much as they are maintaining the type of power that they're accustomed to.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's very disturbing what is happening, because I've been persuaded and still am sometimes, rightly or wrongly, that there is a contingent of people who are wrong for cynical reasons. And obviously, I mean, the other context in American politics is that we are in a capital dominated system, and everybody's relying on corporate money, and that is always obviously going to favor the right. And the Democratic Party is not even historically a left party. There's a left contingent, but you know the many other Democrats have also historically been, a segregationist party. It's been a moderate social reform party. I mean, so there is there are these historical and financial problems. But the other thing that's extraordinary is seeing a certain contingent of people who they really seem to actually believe in this stuff, even as it is electorally, because, the sales pitch with the Clintons was like, look, we know what we're doing. And of course they don't. And that kind of leads me to this other very bizarre kind of freak out that's been happening recently. So a new poll came out, a Harvard Harris survey, basically measuring leading political figures in the country, including 16 Trump administration officials. And Bernie Sanders is viewed favorably by 57% of registered voters. He's the only politician who is viewed favorably by a majority of those polled. Now, again, this is just reality. I know that I'm already in deep Bernie bro territory here, obviously, by even quoting this poll.
Clearly.
That's reality, right? So then, and Steve Bannon, I will have it be noted, comes in bottom at 16%. So maybe there is some hope for humanity. But there has been, Tom Perez is going across a unity tour with Bernie Sanders. We'll play some sound of him later. Perez is finding his, great selling point is he's learning how to curse in his speeches, which really I have to say does him well, because he's a very boring speaker. So as soon as he lets out some profanity, you're like, whoa. Perez, okay, man. But there has been this drumbeat, and granted, always with the caveat that on one hand, Twitter doesn't matter because Twitter isn't real life and normal people don't care about this stuff. But on the other hand, Twitter does matter because Twitter is affecting conversation, who gets booked, where op-eds get placed.
Right.
And on TV, there is a contingent of people who are the new demonized Bernie tactic is he doesn't call himself a Democrat. Has been, correct me if I'm wrong, and I say this very specifically, I want to phrase this really specifically, there is no version of a normal person imaginable, and when I say version, I mean a normal person of anyone from a retiree in upstate New York to a transgender student at university to pretty much any other category of just normal day-to-day person that I can imagine that gives a fuck if Bernie Sanders calls himself a Democrat or not. Am I wrong?
Yeah. No, in the real world, right? And so you made that distinction between the real world of reality and Twitter.
Right.
And keep in mind, so well, actually, let me answer the question first. Nobody cares.
Nobody.
Nobody really cares because the Democratic brand is toxic already. The Democrats are unliked, and they, you know, they in many ways deserve as much animosity as they get. So for him to not be a Democrat is actually a bonus.
Right.
And so, you know, in many ways, he still needs to distinguish himself because what he represents, even though it may be a throwback to FDR style Democrats to some degree, it definitely is not representative of what the Democratic Party is today. So to delineate himself, to distinguish himself rather from the modern Democrats is actually a plus for him in every sense of the word. Now, you made a distinction between real life and Twitter. I firmly believe that 3% of people, of Hillary Clinton supporters, who overwhelmingly dislike, I forgot the exact phrase from the YouGov poll, but they really hate Bernie Sanders. I believe all 3% of them live on Twitter and have accounts. And
like literally live on Twitter. They might actually somehow like have a feeding tube from Twitter or something. It's very bizarre.
I swear, because as soon as one word of positive thought about Bernie Sanders gets out into the atmosphere, I mean, they come in like shit on stink. And they attack him, relentlessly. And it's amazing to me that they're willing to do this instead of at least trying Tom Perez's approach, which is, well, let's at least try to co-opt Bernie for the benefit of us. No, some people still want a scorched earth policy with regard to Bernie Sanders. Now, I'm with you in the sense that it's time to move on past Bernie. He's super popular. Yeah, but he's also 74. I don't know exactly his age. He's going to be too old to run in 2020.
He is staffing up. But anyways, regardless.
I don't want to be ageist, but still, you know, there is a upper end of your age spectrum for you to be the president of the United States. And I think Bernie Sanders is approaching that very quickly. And not just that, though, we need more leaders. We need more people We definitely need more people that can be that voice, that the person that people can look to, and to continue to relitigate the primaries is not going to really move us forward. But we almost can't help but do it when that 3% who really hate Bernie Sanders, despite the 57% who like him, that 3%, they're very, very focused like a laser on attacking Bernie, because I think they still get checks for doing it or something. I mean,
there's some people that you really wonder. Right. Totally. That it's just so bizarre and so fixated. But on the flip side, I would say that, you know, people continue to now who obsess about, you know, hating Hillary, which I also think is ridiculous. The only distinction I would make is that, you know, there's books coming out, and if we're going to do these autopsies, I mean, I think frankly the lessons of why Hillary lost are really obvious, and some of them have to do with things that were not,
but they're important too, though.
Yeah, no, and some of them are not in her control. Some of them were unfair, and some of them are really important, and absolutely because they ran an awful campaign. And if you can't be an adult enough to recognize that, you're never going to be in a position to sort of right these wrongs. This is great. We only have another minute, but I want you to announce something that is very exciting and certainly I'm looking forward to, and is richly deserved.
Thanks, man. Yeah, so tonight I will be hosting a show for The Intercept with Glenn Greenwald, Jeremy Scahill, the whole team over there, something we've been working on for a little while. So I'll be streaming live, taking over their entire Facebook page. I'll be having a conversation with Glenn and a couple of professors, some pertinent issues. We have a really deep dive into regime change, the statistics on our success rate, our failure rate. I think it's going to be a fascinating conversation, and we're hoping that this goes really well because it's something that they want to incorporate going forward. So, you know, honored to be tapped by them to do this. And, you know, if things go well, Mike, I want to have you on as soon as possible.
Well, anytime, of course. I mean, I'm a big fan, man. You know, you're one of these people that I've kind of met in this sort of crazy new ecosystem we're working on. And, you know, people send you a lot of stuff and kind of point you to a lot of things. And, you know, I don't want to kind of drag anybody, but there's a lot that you're like, okay, well, there's a new YouTube channel. Yeah. Fair enough.
Yeah.
And, I was always a very, very smart guy and very high integrity. And I really appreciate your work, and I'm glad to see it getting out. And of course,
thanks,
I'll join you anytime, and I look forward to having you on again soon.
Awesome.
And all of our conversations. So congratulations, man. And everybody, you know, follow Ben on Twitter, and also just check out the whole situation over there with Noah and Brendan and all of that. There's great work you guys are doing. All right, man. I appreciate it so much. I'll talk to you soon.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Yeah, of course. All right, bye-bye. Okay, everybody, we are going to go to the fun half. Become a member of the Majority Report today. Where else are you going to get an in-depth conversation with Ronnie Kasrils like that? I mean, honestly. I got jealous. I wanted to be at that wedding in Jamaica, man, with Amy Goodman. Imagine partying in Jamaica with Amy Goodman and Ronnie Kasrils.
I'm jealous of Ronnie Kasrils all the time, every day.
I'll email him and let him know. You can subscribe to us on iTunes, obviously. Subscribe to the YouTube channel. Still, obviously, putting videos up there as we figure out, and actually, we did a really deep dive on this for Two Dope Boys in a Podcast on demonetization, the future of journalism, and really sort of how to play in these spaces that are designed as commons but are actually corporate spaces, and how our whole cultural understandings and regulatory frameworks don't match with the reality. So subscribe to Two Dope Boys in a Podcast. 646-257-3920, 646-257-3920. I want to thank everybody personally that came out to the Bell House. It was amazing meeting people, and it was awesome. See you on the fun half. You never